circulating among the people like Gregoire, the way you taught me. And I want a sign from you, Ephraim, sometime today, that you approve. No, it won't be an end in the sense that we have one, but I will make it happy. Become tired, Ephraim, tired of living from hand to mouth. And I want that sign from you.
This is Levi.
Sometime today. Now don't you worry, Mr. Kemper. We'll get to Yonkers, you'll marry Ermengarde, just leave everything up to me.
Getting married. Well, I was young once. That was foolish. I was poor once, and that was foolish. I got married once. That was the most foolish thing. But then my wife died, and, well, that was foolish of her. And I grew old and mean and rich and friendless, and Yonkers, that's about as far as you can go. Now, I'm getting married again because, well, to be honest with you, without a wife, this place is just an empty shell, and, well, it's pretty messy, too. It takes a woman about her to think, to joyously clean out the drain and the sink. And it takes an angel with long golden lashes and soft dressed in fingers for dumping the ashes. Yes, it takes a woman, a dainty woman, a sweetheart, a mistress, a wife. Oh yes, it takes a a fragile woman to bring you the sweet things in life. That's a young man who's constantly there for washing and blueing and chewing the mare. Yes, it takes a female for washing the table and cleaning the curtain and cleaning the stable. Yes, it takes a woman a day. dainty woman, a sweetheart of his graceful wife. Oh, yes, it takes a woman, a fragile woman, to bring you all the sweet things in life. And lovingly set out the traps for the mice. She's a joy and treasure for whom we can turn to when the plumbing is weak.
It takes a woman all out of it. 33 years old, and I still don't have a meeting off. When am I going to begin to live?
You can always have some holidays for your kids.
Oh, but do you remember what we did last Christmas? All those canned tomatoes were bad and exploded and went everywhere, made the worst smell in the world. And who was left to clean it up? Me and you. Do you call that living?
No.
Barney? You and I are going to New York.
What, can you close the store?
Yep.
Pretty easy. We can't do that.
We'll have to. Some more rotten tomato cans are going to explode.
How do you know?
Because I'm going to light this candle into them.
Holy goodness!
They'll explode, make a terrible smell. We'll have to close the shop for 24 hours. That'll give us the evening off. We're going to New York, Barney. We're going to live. We're going to have a nice meal. We're going to be in danger. We're going to get arrested.
Holy goodness!
Oh, and one more thing. We're not coming home until we beach kiss the girl.
Cornelius, you can't do that. You don't know any girls.
I'm 33 years old. It's about time I met some.
Well, I'm only 17. It's not so urgent for me.
Come on, Barnaby. It's New York. The lights of Broadway. The elevated trains. Ha! The stuffed whale Barnes Museum.
A stuffed whale?
A stuffed whale. What do you say, old chap?
Yes, Cornelius, yes!
Listen, Barnaby. Listen.
Terry's a once more cherries and feathers to catch a beau, I suppose. Although, if you ask me, she'd do better with a nice heavy bib.
I told her who was that and that is what we wear in the summer to catch a gentleman's eye, but she had none of it. Cherries and feathers, and on today of all days, when poor, dear, sweet Miss Malloy has enough on her mind, what with...
With what, honey?
With the door. It's stuck.
It's stuck with a push.
It's a vivid
adventure I want now. We will get them all heated up and then drop them cold. It'll be great practice for married life. Now, you know how much of a work room. I know some places are perfect for our appearances. Besides, it's kind of a way to make them nervous and easier for us to.
And you say vampire. Awesome.
Vampire.
Wow!
Nothing happens. Then we come to the quietest street corner in all of New York, and suddenly, is Doc there? Go check. He's sitting on that bench. Are you really sure this isn't an adventure? Barnaby, you don't have to ask. You'll know when it's won. All right, now how much money do we have left?
Not much. 40 cents for the train, 30 cents for dinner, and 20 cents to see the lamp. 90 cents, why?
Okay. When those women come back in here, we'll make them think we're customers. Customers! That's it! And what better than to make them think we're rich? That way, we won't have to buy anything. All right, now listen. We're two men, about the town, looking for hats for ladies. Ah, good afternoon, miss.
Lloyd.
Here, for you, this apple. Here, borrow your cousin.
My pleasure, Mrs. I know. What can I do for you?
Oh, you see our hats, ladies. We want to buy something after you. We're looking for a hat. Furley, of course, and everyone said to come to Miss Malloy's because she's so pretty. I mean, because her hats are so pretty.
And so reasonable, too, Cornelius. As little as under a dollar, Cornelius enough to see that whale.
You'll have to pay him no attention, then. He's come all the way from Yonkers to see the whale. Go look outside, Barnaby. You might see it pass by.
Is it big and mean with beating with lies?
Yup.
Why, it's sitting right on that bench.
Excuse me, Mr. Hackle, but did you say Yonkers?
Yes, I did. In fact, you should see Yonkers. And by that, I mean maybe Mr. Leroy would like to see Yonkers as well.
I don't know, Mr. Hackle.
You're she's a widow, Barnaby! I'm so sorry. Mr. Leroy, may he rest in peace. Your path will go to everyone to change. Mrs. Malloy, if you shall ever happen to have Sunday evening free, I'd be more than willing to show you Yonkers from top to bottom.
Well, as a matter of fact, Mr. Hackle, I may be there sooner than you think.
Oh, really?
You see, I have a friend who lives in Yonkers.
Do you now?
Perhaps you know him?
Perhaps we do.
Although I know it's silly to ask in cases like this. It's a Mr. Vanderbilt.
Horace Vanderbilt?
Vanderbilt's
hand
thing? Oh, do you know him? Oh, no, of course not.
Oh, Mr. Vanderbilt is a substantial man and well-liked,
tell me. Well-liked indeed, Miss Malloy. He only has one fault that we know. He's hard as nails.
Cornelius, I think...
I've never come out like this one.
Look out! Excuse us, Miss Malloy. We'll explain everything later.
What are you doing?
We're going to take a peek, Mrs. Malloy.
Oh, really? Mr. Hackle? Mr. Tucker, I insist that you both come out at this minute or I'll be
your... Miss Malloy!
Mr. Radio.
I suppose you haven't seen Mrs. Levi. I think she's supposed to be out there on that bench about 10 minutes ago. And she's late. Well, kick your back. Here, I brought you a gift. Chocolate covered peanuts, unshelled, salted. The expensive kind. Now, that's you when you're talking to
men. Men? Men, Mr. Mega Governor? What would men be doing in a lady's half shop? Now, come back and think of my workroom. I'm so anxious for you to see it.
Oh, I saw last week.
Oh, so you did. Well, Mr. Mega Governor, what's new with the hanging feet business? I hear you have three friends, all hard as nails. I mean...
What are you talking about?
Yonkers. I hear it's a beautiful city.
And who's been telling you about Yonkers?
Nobody. Well, a friend.
A friend?
Well, you see, he...
He?
A customer, Mr. Vanderbilt, someone quite well to do as a matter of fact. He was in here buying hats for ladies. Now, perhaps you might know him, although I know it's foolish to ask in cases like this. It's a Mr. Cornelius Hackle.
Hackle? Cornelius Hackle?
Yes.
Only that's my chief purpose, boy. I demand an explanation.
And I'm going to give it to you. Why shouldn't you know Cornelius Hackle? Everyone in New York knows Cornelius Hackle. Why, he's here in the opera and the fancy houses. Why, he's at the Harmonia Gardens restaurant 3 times a week.
Now, Miss Levi, that's impossible, because Cornelius Hathaway only has $146.38, which I keep in my own personal safe.
Oh, Mr. Vanderbilt, you're killing me. He's one of the Hathaways. They built the canal, you know.
What canal?
The Erie Hall. Both.
It can't be the same man.
Who took the horses out of Miss Lynn's carriage and dragged the carriage himself? Cornelius? And who dressed up as a waiter and dropped the horse down Miss Astor's? Oh, I can't say, but it was Cornelius. He's the playboy of New York, you know. Why, I'm reading the same by him too, don't deny it?
Oh, don't let me say it. I've only seen him once in my life.
Really, golly, I don't know.
Excuse me.
Oh, of course. Now, as I was saying.
What?
Look here, Mr. Levi, that's a man's fault.
No, Mr. Vanderbilt, you can't. It's too dangerous.
Any man wants the woman's club to not care if he stands up.
No man indeed. I bet you can make short work of any man. Why, I can see the muscles underneath your coat now. Rippling back and forth. Ripple, ripple, ripple. Back and forth. Ripple, ripple, ripple.
For the last time, Mr. Levi, stand aside.
Stand indeed, Mr. Vanderbilt. That is precisely what the courts will have you do if you're found entering that vault without a search warrant. And what do you stand for if you don't stand for the laws of this great land? I know what I stand for. I stand for motherhood, America, and a hot lunch for orphans. Take off your hat, sir, as your office flag is passing through.
Mr. Tucker, you may take this day and myself after dinner. Delighted to. And nice to meet you, Barnaby, as well.
Now, let's see. I believe there's a nice restaurant down by the railroad
station. Oh, no. Is the Harmonia Party just good enough for you and your fashionable friends? It's good enough for us. I get to have a lot of orchestra there, Eddie.
We couldn't go there. It's not the money or anything.
It's the whale!
Yes, it's the whale! No, it's not the whale, Barnaby. It's the dancing. You see, they have dancing in a place like that, and I don't know how. It could take me weeks, once even years, to learn how.
Mrs. Dolly Levi's 33-year-old clerks taught how to dance.
Now, it's very simple. Just put one head here.
I have absolutely no sense of rhythm.
Why, absolutely no sense of rhythm is one of the primary requirements for learning about the Levi Gallagher method. Just give me 5 minutes of your time, Mr. Hacker, and we'll have you dancing in the streets. Now, let's start with lesson 7, the waltz pick turn. Right together, left together, under, back, around, together, under, unfurl. Oh, wonderful, when I think of the woman who will find heaven in your arms. Now let's go back to lesson 1. Put your hand on her waist. Take her right and your left hand. Good. And 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3.
Look! I'm dancing!
Or it was.
Well, of course you were, Mr. Hackle.
Thank you. Thank you.
said and more.
Hold on, Miss Money, I'm coming!
Oh, hey! You can come out and stop! It's my thief! That's my fiance! I paid for her! I want all of her parts! This seems like the meaning of this!
Lawrence, it's nothing to get upset about. Miss Money had a sudden urgent meeting at the Mint. They were running a little short and needed her help. But she will meet you at the Harmonia Gardens restaurant tonight at 8 o'clock.
The Harmonia Gardens? I mean, that's the most expensive restaurant in the city.
As well, it should be. Oh, what food! And the fastest waiters in New York. Now, Horace, I might be a little late, but Ernestina will be wearing purple and singing an old tune like Sweet Rosie O'Grady.
All right, Ernestina, I'll be there, but I want you to know, from here on out, you're no longer my married girl. You're just a woman to me. All right, darling Levi? All right? Hey! Stop it! Why are you taking me? Hey, stop that! Stop it! Ah!
My Hermes as good as mine.
Set changes for you. There's refreshments out there. Welcome back in about 10 minutes. People just don't take axe.
Axe is out.
They all go by streetcar.
J.P. Vanderbilt, Dimension Morgan.
I wasn't by all means a streetcar. Imagine that. I've been elegant my whole life and I didn't even know it.
Of course, if you really want to be elegant.
Oh, me too.
You walk.
Yes, New York. It's really a party.
We are out, we're trying to kiss, and I can't take it.
Thank you.
didn't make a mistake, Cornelius. Actually,
I'll
hurt
you. I
can't
get
it,
but.
No, don't.
I can't
afford it. I'm going to hurt you. Thank you. Wait
here.
Thank you.
Excuse me, waitress! Waitress
here. Give this to the manager and tell him to play the waltz, please.
Excuse me, here's a nickel. Would you ask the band to play Through a Wild Rose?
Honey! Another message, please!
Cornelius!
Excuse me, waitress!
My wallet!
It's my purse!
Excuse me, I believe that's my wallet.
This money, how dare you get to the stew, please!
I know that because it only has a dollar, three dimes, five pennies, and,
Cornelius! Cornelius!
If he say two pheasants, make it three pheasants, four pheasants, pheasants for the house! If for keeping by himself, I'll have to buy my own!
Ma'am! Ma'am, she's here! The lady!
What's this?
Carriage and asked after the tall lady with red hair and the biggest head I've ever seen.
Oh my God!
Oh my God!
Oh my God!
Look,
I didn't bring that up.
Oh, I certainly Wait to see with our food. Oh, here, Johanna. I'll serve this to Ben and the others. Some chicken, white meat. Oh, some dumplings, lighter than air they are. Some giblets, very tender, very good for you. No horses, I'm saying. You go your way, and I'll go mine. Oh, the way you see with our wine. This'll calm me down. Now that you brought it up, there's one more thing I feel I ought to say.
What's that?
One more thing I feel I ought to say, and then we can forget all about it. It's true that I'm a woman who likes to be in control, who likes to manage things, but I wouldn't like to manage anything that's out of control with your house. No, you'll have to do that by yourself, God help you.
Okay, my house is not out of control.
Very well, we won't say another word about it. Here, have some beets, they're good.
I don't like beets.
Oh, but they're good for you. No horse, of course, some friendless, complaining to a lady would be no sort of companion for someone like me. You've got your beets, and I'll stop mine.
Stop saying that!
Very well, let's say another word. Except this. I would think at your age you would enjoy hearing the honest truth.
My age, darling? Why do you always talk about my age?
Well, I don't know what your age is, but I do know that I've been on with bad food and bad company. You'll double in 6 months. Here, have some more beets.
I don't like beets! I hate beets!
That's it. Now, the pity of it all is that you could be a perfectly charming, witty, admirable man if you only wanted to be.
I don't want to be charming, though.
Oh, but you can't help it. Look at you. Now, let's talk about something else. Just one last thing.
It's for me to ask you to marry me, darling. I just forget about it.
Oh, so I suppose you want me to ask you? Well, of course, I'm sorry. I'm turning you down.
Well, you can't turn me down without me back.
No need to argue. I've made up your mind.
I have a headache. I'm going back to my hotel room.
You can't leave now. The competition's about to begin.
Here's 20 dollars. But there's nothing in here. This is not my purse. A dollar, 3 dimes, 4 pennies, and a button. This isn't my purse. I have lost my purse.
Barnaby.
That is falling, Charles.
Impossible. I can't have you without your purse.
It's Daniel. It's 20 minutes. You've got to get out of here.
Sure.
Oh, lady, what about
I can't do it!
That's better. Now then, you're all charged with disturbing the peace, enticing a riot, assault and battery, and several other serious violations of the law of this city. Now I say, is there anyone here to speak on your behalf? I say, is there anyone here to speak on your behalf? Mrs. Dolly Levi, counselor at law.
Your Honor, the defense rests. No, ladies and gentlemen, there is no need to call in witnesses. When I see upon that bench a brow that gleams with honor, a pair of dark brown whiskers that bristle with fair play, and a nose, I ask you to look at that nose, ladies and gentlemen, that shines in the night like a beacon of justice. Your Honor, could you turn this way a bit so we can get a better look at your beacon? Oh, a living symbol of the motto of this great land, E Probuscus Unum. Now, Your Honor, I ask for freedom for my clients and a guilty verdict for the one true culprit, Mr. Horace Van Gogh of Yonkers, New York. The one man responsible for these grievous charges of willful destruction of private property.
A curtain torn, a vapor bruised, and a cellar door bent,
and cruelty to this poor, unfortunate minor. Would you mind repeating that, my dear?
Mrs. Levi, I have something to say if it pleases the court.
Go right ahead, I was just about to call on you.
Dare testify against me, Cornelius Hackle, and I'll have you fired. You've already done that, Mr. Van Gogh. Well, then I'll do it again! You've done it again, too. And even if you hadn't, I'd still say what I have to say. Now, I don't know much about enticing a rider, disturbing the peace, but I do know what happened to me today. It might never have happened if I was staying in your shop. Your Honor, I'm talking about none other than love!
Love?
Look, okay. You mean to tell me that after 33 years, you've taken one night, say, off, and you've fallen in love? No, Mr. Van Gelder. I didn't fall in love with Miss Irene Malloy of the city in just a night. An hour! No, even that's too long. What's less than a minute?
A second!
Less than that!
A moment.
A moment. That's it. I'll go slow so you can get on out.
I'll be a ditch digger who once had a wonderful day.
Oh,
Wave your little hand and
I wouldn't marry you, even if you're the last woman on earth. You asked me a million times, but I didn't need you then, and I don't need you now. No, you go your way, Dolly, and I'll go mine. Dolly, Dolly.
You said this is very young.
What say you want? Come back to your job, eh?
No, Mr. Bennett Gelder. I'm actually here for my $146.38. You see, I decided I'd open my own store. And since the only business I know is paying you, I decided I'd open my own shop.
And Cornelius has found the perfect location, Mr. Bennett Gelder. Right across the street from you.
So you think you can pay for Bennett Gelder to pay a fee now, do you? Well, I'd like to see you try. Aha, another one! Come crawling back to your job as well, eh?
My back's on me. My $6.12.
Oh, look, you can't do this. I'll get lawyers. I'll go to court.
You know, thinking about it, I think I'll call it Cornelius Payne.
It's ridiculous.
Aren't we handy to work way better?
Okay, guys, come on. Don't do this to me. I've got everyone to love. Yes. You're my best friend, I guess.
Cornelius and Martin hate me.
We'll talk about it.
You guys can both have to leave. I'm still left here all alone. Fantastic, sir.
My horse, don't you look handsome? So few men nowadays have the courage to pull off sleeves.
Oh, yes.
I know a horse who weren't satisfied with Ernestina. Well, I happen to have one more person on my list, the ideal wife. But let's not talk about that now. I interrupted you. You were doing something. What were you doing? Oh, just getting Cornelius' money, Dolly. $146.
And 38 cents. $5 and 12 cents.
And the money my mama left me.
$52 and 48 cents.
38!
48!
All right, it's money, you guys, but the safe stuff's scared.
Money, 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 Mr. Vanderbilt's money. It's the very sun we walk under, it can kill or cure. Vanderbilt is so fond of saying that people in this world are fools, and maybe he's right. Himself, Irene, Cornelius, myself, we're all just fools in danger of destroying the whole world. And the only thing keeping us from destroying it is the four or five pleasures we can have as humans. And that requires a little money. The difference between a little money and no money at all is enormous if you shadow the whole world. And the difference between a little money and an enormous amount of money is very slight if you shadow the world also. As my late husband after we always said, money, pardon the expression, is like manure. It doesn't do much good unless it's spread around encouraging young things to grow, but that's just the advice of the future Mrs. Vanderbilt. Which reminds me, I'm ready for that sign.
That goes upstairs.
As I was saying, Boris, I found the ideal wife.
Oh, Dolly, I don't want you to find me no ideal wives. If I want a woman, I'll find her myself. Well, I think I found one. Well, it's you, Dolly. Would you marry me?
Why, Boris?
I mean, I know I was a fool with that Miss Boy, that Miss Molly woman, but I love you. Would you please?
Why, Boris, you stop it right there.
Why would you
want to do? You know as well as I do that you're the first citizen of Yonkers, and your wife has to be a somebody. Tell me, Horace, am I somebody?
Yes, you are. You're a wonderful woman.
No, you can't just load your wife up with jewels and money and insist that she be a benefactor to half the city. Which reminds me, you can't let Cornelius open up a store next door. It's bad business, no. We'll have to let him back and take him on as your partner.
Partner?
And why don't you have Cornelius' old job?
Now look here, Dolly.
That way we can all be together and dance in Ermengarde's wedding.
All right, that's good. You've gone too far this time, Dolly. I've been dancing no wedding. And besides, we don't have to dance and take weeks or months to be in here. Well, I guess I'll dance then.
Oh, Horace, I never thought you'd say anything so wonderful.
That wasn't the front room, you idiot!
What in the world is going on up there, Horace?
I'm just having the front room done up in blue wallpaper.
My horse.
I know the old wallpaper's not all worn out yet, but I figured she's just grown up and she'll be used to start with his daughter. Well, like I've always said, none of them can do it, ain't worth nothing for us.
Thank you. You're looking at the single largest team at GCA. That's for you. Let me do a quick prayer from us, and you can go up and tell them how awesome they did. Dear Lord, we thank you. We thank you for the